Loud and clear. Okay, I'd very much like to explain to you how I look at black holes, the problem of quantization of black holes, and certain priorities which clearly are different from other people's approaches. And one of my priorities is that I want to use the laws of nature as I know them, as much as I can, and only if there's a point where really there is no information to be gained from the textbooks on physics, then you start inventing something else. But don't do that too soon. Is this better? Okay. So my philosophy is that we should apply the known laws of physics first. It's maybe a Trump-like statement, the known physics first, and then only if you are at the point that all the law books of physics don't say anything about how to go, where to go next, then you might invent your own ideas. But for a while, we just go and apply laws of physics, and I think one can get a very far understanding why there is no information paradox with black holes. Not everything is solved. There's still many things you don't understand. For instance, what today's law books in physics don't say is what happens at the Planck scale. For various reasons, we have no experimental information, but also we do know very well that quantum mechanics doesn't go very well with gravitation, so there are still many questions there. Then you might decide to invent your own new ideas, but don't do it too soon. That's the message. And so what I end up with is not really a model, it's not really an idea, it's just a calculation. I calculate the things I can calculate, and only in the very end I say, well, and now there's something is missing. What's missing, among others, is a boundary condition, and there is what's missing is a certain interpretation of particles, which I'll explain. You might replace the particle by the effect it has on gravity, on space-time, which is it causes curvature of space-time, and you replace the particle by the curvature that it generates. So I'll explain how that goes. So that is something which is not in today's textbooks, but can easily be added without too much problem. This is the a microscope view of the region where the two horizons cross, and traditionally we replace them by region 1, 2, 3, and 4. And a very important notion there is so-called Hartle-Hawking vacuum, which is what you get if you assume that in ordinary coordinates, not light cone coordinates, but in rectangular coordinates, there are no particles. So this is just a vacuum. But now if you rearrange the vacuum to look at eigenstates of the eigenstates of those operators which rotate this red line as being the new Cauchy surface of the system, then that generates a new Hamiltonian, a new ground state, and new excited states. And so you'd express the vacuum here in terms of the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian here. It turns out that there are two Hamiltonians, one sitting at this side of the horizon, one sitting at the other side. And if you want a vacuum here, you'll have an eigenstate of the Hamiltonian of the sum of the two spaces. And so you have two states, E and N in region 1 and E and N in region 2. And this particular quantum combination then generates the vacuum. That's the origin of Hawking radiation, because the standard interpretation is that first of all, region 2 and region 4 are not considered to be physical, because the black hole has formed by an imploding matter, and imploding matter comes in along this direction like that. So imploding matter screens off, as it were, this region from the visible parts of the universe. So region 2 and region 4 are not really there. But region 1 and region 3 is. Region 3 is unusually interpreted as being something like the inside, whatever it means, the inside of the black hole. What comes out at this side of the horizon. What goes at the other side of the horizon stays in or disappears or what have you. So that, according to the standard rules, you have to sum over all those states, and so you have to sum over all states in region 2, and then you get a mixed state. That's a standard thing if you have entangled states, and one part of the entangled states is not observed, then the remainder behaves like a thermal state. And that would be Hawking's argument, and you can compute. You find that you have to square this thing to get e to the minus beta e, where beta is the inverse temperature, and then you get the Hawking temperature. The rule I'm going to use is that all in and outgoing particles will have energies e, which in principle can be arbitrarily large. Well, this E cannot be so large because there's this damping factor in front. So this E stays in reasonable places. But if you look at the original observer here, which describes the whole region as flat space, that observer will see particles with any energy, because the incoming particles with a tremendous amount of energy, as seen by the observer here. And so will the late Hawking particles. They'll also carry lots and lots of energy for this observer here, but not in these terms. So this is a situation that we want to understand better. And the first thing I'm going to use is a distinction between what I call hard particles and soft particles. You can imagine what I mean by that. A particle is soft if its energy and its mass and everything are low enough so that the effect they have on the metric of space-time is negligible. So when we do quantum field theory, we'll use only soft particles, and that will be a rule. The soft particles are described very accurately in today's textbooks. We have quantum field theory, which handles particles where you can ignore the effect they have on the background metric. But that means that their energy shouldn't be too big. Now the problem with that is, in the case of black holes, is that near the horizon, you have all states that you get by Lorentz boosting the original particles. But if you Lorentz boost a soft particle, it may become a hard particle. A hard particle is a particle which has so much energy that it has an effect on space and time. And then you have to think again very hard what you have to do. So the theorem I'm going to explain is that to describe a black hole, I can need the original combination of horizons. And here, I now plug in extra particles. So originally, the local observer sees nothing, just vacuum. Now I'm going to look at the states where the local observer sees particles. But I limit myself to soft particles, because that's the situation I can handle. Whereas if you have particles with energies beyond the Planck mass, then this local observer doesn't know what to do, because the whole space and time gets curved in all sorts of ways, and you get lost very quickly. But the theorem is, if you only use soft particles, you will get the entire Hilbert space of a black hole. That is very surprising. At first sight, you would say, no, that can't be. You can't just ignore the hard particles. That is correct, but there's a way to handle them separately, and I'll explain how that goes. So if you do this not quite correctly, to my taste, is then you get the firewalls. And the firewalls means that some particles will necessarily become hard particles. A hard particle causes curvature of space and time. You no longer know what to do. And according to standard theory, you'll get a curtain of hard particles going along both horizons. The past horizon, there it is very well understood what the past horizon does, because that's the imploding particles which make a black hole. And yes, that's a very violent event. You could call it quantum mechanical, but actually it's an imploding star. It's something very big and 99% classical. It's extremely energetic particles which have a big effect on space-time. In fact, they generate the black hole altogether. So there's a firewall on the past horizon, and nobody's surprised about that. But then if you put pure states in the thing and you wait long enough, then the Hawking particles also become hard particles which generate a firewall. So the whole thing is then surrounded by firewalls. Now, if you look at the entire history of the black hole, this is what I've just been talking about, you have the gravitational implosion in its distant past, you have the Hawking radiation in its future, but also in its distant future. The Hawking radiation in its distant future, if you extrapolate that back to now, you get very, very energetic hard particles. So we have to deal with that situation at some point. But the theory is that to get Just use only the soft particles and then see how to put the hard particle in at a later stage. And that works amazingly well. The argument goes as follows. In principle, both the ingoing particles, which make the explosion, the implosion of the black hole, and the late Hawking particles all generate their firewall. So all you have is region number one. It makes no sense to extrapolate beyond that point because the firewall will completely deform space and time. It will generate tremendous curvature. So you can't really expand beyond those two regions. But the problem with this is now you can also not see that there's Hawking particles because Hawking particles were assuming that this firewall wasn't there. And that's the apparently contradictory situation in general relativity. If you follow an imploding black hole, you don't see this firewall, so it isn't there. So there is a ambiguity in the law book of physics. So now you have to start watching out. There's something which doesn't quite work right. What you want to do, if you normally consider a black hole, just like Hawking does, in fact, you say, well, the ingoing particles are there, but if you want to describe Hawking particles, you have to take the vacuum state as seen here, expand it into the new particle states that you have, which are the particle states of the distant observer. And you see the Hawking particles going out this way. You also see Hawking particles coming in region 3, but I would like to draw the arrow the other way around. Doesn't matter. These are geodesics, and they cause curvature regardless whether you consider them as a particle going in this way or an antiparticle going that way. In both cases, they describe the geodesic, and they would generate curvature of space-time if you're not careful. But the standard derivation of Hawking, when he derives Hawking particles, is that these particles have no effect on the space-time metric. What do you mean by that? Well, what he really means is that he is only considering soft particles, not the hard particles. They are somehow not properly included in the argument. So now, but now there's a very important thing. I had it on the view graph. I forgot to mention it, which is that if you have a theory for pure states of the black hole, you must assume time reversal invariance. If you describe the black hole as a thermal state, thermodynamics is not invariant in the time reversal. But pure quantum mechanics is. So my description of black hole must be invariant under flipping from time to minus time. But this picture is not. The imploding particles are treated totally different from the outgoing particles. Why is that? Well, what I really want is this situation, where also ingoing particles are described by Hawking's theory. This picture is time reversal invariant. But you can ask, wait a minute, but the imploding particles are very different from Hawking particles. How can I do that? Well, it's a lie. They are not different at all. They are very similar. If you look at Hawking particles, you might put a detector here, but the detector might specialize on, might single out very special particles. The detector is not sensitive to all particles. Many particles it doesn't see. So you tune the detector to see only a very special subset of particles, and those particles you can measure, and then you get Hawking's result. Well, the time reverse of a particle selecting out, of a detector selecting out special particles, the time reverse of that is a source of particles which only produce very special particles, such as the imploding matter of the black hole. So you can take the time reverse of these Hawking particles and consider that as describing all the ingoing particles. So it does make sense. But then you see now the picture becomes symmetric. But now you can also say, now I've removed also the hard particles from the horizon here. Now I can easily extrapolate that to get the entire Penrose diagram of the eternal black hole. I've removed not only the outgoing particles at late times, but also the ingoing particles at early times. This way I can handle the black hole, and I claim it works. And so here you can apply only the laws of physics that you know about, which you can look up in the textbooks. You just do quantum field theory, you do this transformation to this new basis, and on you go. You just calculate whatever you want to know. So that should take care of the information problem, but it does not, because we have a problem. And the problem is that, yes, I forgot the hard particles. And if I let time go on, sooner or later, late Hawking particles will become very energetic for the early observer. The early imploding particles will become very energetic for the late observer. So those will become hard particles, and I forgot to include them in the picture. So when you forget that, you're making a mistake. So now we have to correct for that mistake. And So the distinction is that a firewall contains very many different quantum states, whereas the Hartle-Hawking state has only one state where there's no firewall. So we have to go from one state to very many different states. We have to decompose, as it were, the Hartle-Hawking state, both as connected with the future particles and the past particles. In all cases, we have to split the state into many different states and then ask how they involve, how they interact. But that splitting then generates hard particles. So I have to do something about that. I have also something to do about region 1 and region 2. So what does region 2 really mean? So the standard answer to that is region 2 actually sends particle to region 3, and region 3 describes the inside of the black hole. That was the formal argument. I claim that as a mistake. That is where I'm not going along. Region 3 does not describe the inside of the black hole, and region 2 does not describe the inside of the black hole. It describes some other part of the black hole. Now, I'll come back to that. First, I want now to explain what to do with the hard particles. And what you have to do there is take the back reaction into account. The hard particles are going so fast that they cause curvature of space and time. You cannot ignore that. If you do, you're making a big mistake. Because what happens? Imagine you have an ordinary particle like a neutrino or a photon, or, well, maybe a neutrino is a better example. It's a very, very light particle. You just take a neutrino, I put it here at rest, it does absolutely nothing to space-time. Its mass is less than an electron volt. And imagine the gravitational field of a neutrino. Forget it, that's totally nothing. But I can now boost the neutrino to get very high energies. Soon enough, the energy of the neutrino will become as big as hundreds of thousands of GeV. And if I boost more and more and more, I'll reach the Planck energy. And I can go beyond that. And the thing about the interior of the black hole is that for the local observer, what is time for the distant observer is the Lorentz boost parameter for the local observer. Very soon, the Lorentz boost parameter, even for a thing as light as a neutrino, it will go beyond the Planck mass in energy. And then you have to calculate what does it do to the surrounding metric. And that calculation is simple. You have to be careful because you can easily make a mistake, but if you calculate that, you find a very simple result, that this is the world line of a very, very fast neutrino. All the particles which pass it from this direction will be shifted along. So the space-time that it generates is very simple to describe. It's flat space before, flat space after the neutrino, but these two flat spaces are joined together in a curved way, and that curvature is a singular curvature. It's only a curvature in the transverse space of this world line, and so it's a delta-peaked curvature, and the effect of the curvature is that things hop at a certain distance. And if this delta u would be independent of the transverse coordinates, you could easily shift these flat spaces back together again. But no, delta u depends on the transverse coordinates, and this is the expression that you calculate. The minus 4 is the most difficult part of the calculation, and Newton's constant, obviously, you expect. The shift is proportional to the momentum, p minus. These are light cone coordinates. U minus is a light cone. Is this shift in the light direction. P minus is momentum in the same direction, so they're both minus. And delta u, the shift, is proportional to P minus. And then this log makes it non-trivial. It depends logarithmically on the transverse coordinates. X tilde are the two transverse coordinates left over. So you have space and so you have the two light cone coordinates plus the two transverse coordinates. Calculation, has been done by myself and Tiefenthaven David long ago by Eichelberg and Sechsel and also by Bonner. They did the flat space time. What we did is we added the background metric of a black hole to that. But that's very straightforward. What happens on the horizon of black hole is as easy to calculate as it happens in flat space time, Minkowski space time. So you see now why I wanted to use the Penrose diagram, but I want to include this back reaction effect. That's the non-trivial part. That's where the hard particles become different from the soft particles. They have this back reaction effect. So in the beginning, I only use short time intervals. But as soon as the time interval becomes too large, and that happens very quickly, if the time interval becomes too large, I have to include this back reaction. And soft particles might pass the borderline between soft and hard. And where exactly you put this borderline is up to you, in a sense. But you very quickly you'll find out where to put the borderline, and I'll explain that. So the quantum field theory forces, theories generate forces, but they are weak and they are renormalizable. So they stay weak, relatively weak all the way to the Planck scale. I'm not worried about the QCD forces. I am worried about the gravitational forces. Why? Well, this shift that I talk about is proportional to the momentum. So the bigger the boost I make, the bigger is the shift effect. It becomes so big that after a while, everybody who tries to get beyond to the other side of that space will die, because you'll be torn apart. Even my single neutrino, you can be torn apart by this, you could say the tidal forces of this whole thing. But it's easy to calculate. And now, so what I'll do now is, I have an ingoing particle with momentum P minus. It causes a shift for the outgoing particles. And this is the expression. This F is the logarithm I talked about before. But now, when you are in a curved horizon of a black hole, the logarithm is a solution for Laplace equation, delta F equals delta function, but there's a one here, and this one comes from the curvature of the black hole horizon. Of course, I chose units where the black hole has just a radius one, and then you get here a one. And this is the angular Laplacian that you're left over with. So this is a simple Laplace equation for the shift, and this shift should not be ignored. And that's what makes the whole thing non-trivial. So if you have many particles, you might notice that this equation is linear in P. So if I add two or three or four particles, well, the U just becomes the sum of all the contributions from all single particles. So that part is easy. And so I say that delta U is, if I have a single particle of momentum P minus, delta U is this expression. I describe the ingoing particle as in terms of momentum distribution. So there could be a single particle, then the momentum distribution is just a delta function. But if I have many particles, I have many delta peaks for all the ingoing particles. And they all contribute. And so now I'm making here an innocent looking step. I replace delta U by U itself. Why is that? Well, let's take all particles that ever went into the black hole and consider all particles going in and consider all particles going out. All particles going out are shifted by the same amount. All particles going in are contributing in the same way, as seen by this local observer, who sees ingoing particles in the past have a very big P minus, ingoing particles in the future have a small P minus. And for you, it's the other way around. The U out of the early particles is still very small, but of the late particles, for the late particles, it's small, for the early particles, it becomes big. So so now you see that the step from here to here says that I have to consider the separation of all particles outside the light cone, and that separation generated by all the momenta of the ingoing particles. And that works remarkably beautifully. Of course, in terms of the distant observer's time, I write tau, meaning that I extract a factor, a 4G or something like that. The Newton's constant is included in this tau, and the mass of the black hole, the 2GM, I think it's a factor. And in terms of that, the P minus increases as a function of tau. The U plus is the canonically associated operator of P minus that decreases. P plus decreases and U minus increases. That's just applying Lorentz transformation for the local observer. So now, if I replace delta U by U, it means that now the in particles are really replaced by the out particles. So the in particles generate use for the out particles. And if you do this sufficiently carefully, you discover that all the hard ingoing particles are replaced by this transformation in terms of soft outgoing ones. This removes all the hard particles. If you have a hard outgoing particle, you do transformation in the other direction. So hard out particles are replaced by soft ingoing particles and vice versa. So this way you can get rid of all the hard particles, and this works quite well. But now there's another problem which I nearly forgot. So when I first decided, well, let's do the calculation this way, see what happens, I did the calculation, came out beautifully, I got a unitary scattering matrix, and I sent it to the archives. And then I thought, oh my God, what have I been doing? I've been doing something very silly, very wrong. What did I do wrong? Well, I forgot to distinguish region 1 and region 2. There's a question about, or this is before that yet, that's a question I'm asking here. But the other question is, I've used the momentum distribution of the ingoing particles and the position of the outgoing particles, the average position, so the center of mass of all the outgoing particles. But that's not what I want. I want to describe particles in terms of the standard model, in Fock space, the Fock space of the standard model. So I don't want just the momentum distribution, I want all particles. So I have to translate the, I have to look at whatever state I have in the standard model, and then calculate its momentum distribution, P minus of depending on the horizon, and that will be my ingoing state. So the question is, can that be done in a unitary way? I claim yes, because the Fock space contains lots of parameters, of positions of all the particles, but P minus of omega, where omega is a solid angle, also contains lots and lots of information about where all the ingoing particles are going in. So you have to translate one from one language into the other language to describe the ingoing particles in terms of their momentum distribution. Same thing for the outgoing particles, but I'll explain that in a minute. But the other problem was, what's the relation between region 1 and region 2? Because that was what was forgotten, and now, the amazing thing is that you have to take them both into account. So, in region 1, there are ingoing particles and outgoing particles. In I red, out I green. These are the Hawking particles, these are the ingoing particles. And in region 2, you have the same thing. You have ingoing particles going in this direction, because these are the asymptotic domains. This is now time is minus infinity. This is time plus infinity for the outside observer. So for the outside observer, the ingoing particles here go in like this, and the outgoing particles go out like that. So I have doubled up the space-time of a black hole. And now my expressions become usually beautifully unitary, but only in this double space. So I'm describing two black holes rather than one. Remember that, or I'm coming back to that. But the equations become remarkably simple if I do the spherical harmonic expansion. Because I had an operator spread over the horizon, but when you want to do calculations of this sort, nothing is easier than making a spherical wave expansion. Because in spherical waves, you just have to the L and the M, and this equation for the shift of the particles becomes diagonal. Because that's always the case with wave equations, differential equations. If you do a spherical harmonic expansion, you can stick to the same L and M everywhere in your calculation. And instead of having this Laplace equation, I just have divided by L square plus L, plus 1. That plus 1 comes from the minus 1 I showed before. But anyway, the signs are such, this you can easily invert. So you get 1 over L square plus L plus 1. That's the solution of the Laplace equation. And for every L and M, I have only one U minus and one P minus. So this is a very easy equation. So the total momentum of the out particle is replaced by the total positions of the ingoing particle. So now I have, for every L and M, just one position and one momentum. And these become very easy equations which you can solve. And I'm going a bit fast, so you might not be able to follow all the calculations, but what I'm thinking, because what I'm saying is that that you can just do these calculations in a very easy way doing a spherical wave expansion. And since so far I've only been using textbook physics, this is not really a model, this is not really an idea. This is just the idea of applying the laws of physics as I know them. And those laws of physics tell me that the ingoing particles are translated into lots and lots of information about the outgoing particles. This is the calculation, so these light colors are just details. So really, what I want to do now is put in quantum mechanics. And to put in quantum mechanics, you just say that position and momenta are, of course, each other's conjugate. That holds for every individual particle that goes into the black hole. It also holds, if you average them, it continues to hold into the spherical wave expansion. So at every L and M, I have one operator U and one operator P, and they still obey the ordinary quantum mechanical commutation rule. So I can do that now in and notice that U is just a Fourier transform of P. So what I got, the ingoing particle, I described in terms of momentum going in, but the outgoing particles are obtained by Fourier transforming that, because you had a position So this is the kernel of the Fourier transformation. And now I have to go back to the tortoise coordinates that are used by the outside observer. Because you have to remember that you made a coordinate transformation from outside to inside. I have to transform back out. So u is the exponent of a tortoise coordinate, rho, and p is exponent of a similar operator, rho of p. And then you have to remember that if you exponentiate something, you have to take care of its sign. So I had to put the sign explicitly in front. Sigma u is plus or minus 1, and sigma p is plus or minus 1. So, and this plus or minus 1 really tells you whether you're in region 1 or region 2. And now you get that the Fourier transform here covers regions 1 and regions 2 equally. If you take the Fourier transform of a function, you cut the function in half, you say, what happens at the negative axis I'm not interested in. Yes, but then you're Fourier transforming wrong, of course. The Fourier transform covers over the whole domain from minus infinity to plus infinity. So the Fourier transform covers both region 1 and region 2. You're not allowed to remove region 2, of course. So, and now what you want to know is, what is this Fourier kernel in terms of these tortoise coordinates? Very simple, it just exponentiates like this. Then you say, but there's something else I can do, because there's a symmetry. If I multiply the u by constant and divide by p by constant, that's just a Lorentz transformation. The theory is invariant in the Lorentz transformations, so I can use that symmetry of the Lorentz boost. And then you find that you look at plane waves going in and plane waves going out, and then the Lorentz transformation, the Fourier transformation, becomes a non-trivial integral transformation. The Fourier kernel here becomes a gamma function in terms of the way of this wave function kappa, and lo and behold, what you get out there is a scattering matrix. This is a 2x2 matrix saying region 1 and region 2 are talking to each other, and they're off the diagonal components. In fact, the off the diagonal components happens to be bigger than the diagonal components if you look at the positive energy particle going in. So, but this matrix is unitary if I consider both components. F plus square plus F minus square equals 1, then this matrix is unitary. But I should not ignore the off-diagonal components. That means region 1 and region 2 are talking to each other. So I have two black holes which are talking to each other. The Hamiltonian is very simple, a little bit too simple. Some PhD students at our institute went to this calculation and discovered that this was just, in some other coordinates, this is just a dilaton operator, dilatation, and they went from there. And they found out that the system, the quantum system, looks like an inverted harmonic oscillator. But what I found out this way is that the ingoing particles never get the opportunity to become hard particles, because then they turn into particles by Fourier transforming their momentum. And this theory takes the place of an old theory I had a long time ago, where I assumed the brick wall. The brick wall was bouncing particles back against the horizon. That worked physically, qualitatively, but of course, theoretically it was wrong, because there is no brick wall on the horizon. But now what I end up is a soft wall. The ingoing particle is replaced by its Fourier transform, which goes back out. If you boost up the position of a particle, you boost down the Lorentz transform of that. So that's why in and out particles are being interchanged by the Fourier transformation. So the Fourier transformation is a new kind of boundary condition on the black hole horizon, where I had a brick wall and I have the Fourier transformation. It does the same thing and it works. So, but then if the outgoing particle goes too far out, it's outside of the black hole. It's just sitting there doing nothing anymore. It's being registered by my detection apparatus as an outgoing particle. I may ignore it. So ignoring all outgoing particles means ignoring those U's and ignoring the firewall. So this is a firewall transformation, a transformation that removes firewalls. So this is how you can handle black holes, thank you, without having any firewall. And now about those region 1 and region 2, they must be each other's antipode. And the argument for that is very simple. So I say that these two regions must be describing the same black hole. Well, the only option I have is to rotate. If I look at that particle going here, maybe its region 2 is another particle going out somewhere else of the black hole. That is a orthogonal transformation, a member of O3. I'm looking at a member of O3, which is such that its square must be 1. Because if I replace one and two, if I do it again, I get the original picture back. So it's the operator which must be the square, must be one. Ax of x is forbidden. Because if you look at the same spot on the horizon, you get the singularity that you don't want. So I don't want the solution to A if x is x. So I don't want the positive eigenvalues. Well, a squared is 1, there's two eigenvalues, plus or minus 1. I don't want the positive ones. Only the negative ones are there to keep. So the solution to the equation is that I want the orthogonal or rotation, which is the minus the identity. That's the antipodal transformation. You go from one point of the sphere to the opposite point of the sphere. So, conclusion, region 2 must be describing the opposite side of the black hole. It sounds incredible, it sounds completely wrong, but then you discover that actually it could be true, because there's no singularity at all. That is because in the physically relevant domain of what I'm describing here, the coordinate r never gets less than 2gm. In other words, I never need to know what happens at r equals 0. That's a singularity way in the unphysical region. So I ignore that, and then you find that you generate no clash of whatever sort if you think that that region 1 and region 2 are the antipoles. So that's the only new physics I need to put in. And then it all works. So this is another amendment on nature's constitution. Amendment 1 was that I considered the use as a footprint of a particle and removing the footprint and replacing that by the original particle. That was Amendment 1. Amendment 2 is that I have to change the boundary condition in such a way that if you have a Penrose diagram or anything else that describes space and time, you're not allowed to have two points on that describing the same point in the black hole. That's forbidden. A 1 to 2 mapping, as you know, also in quantum mechanics, you can't have one particle described by two particles. Even if they're entangled, you know, you violate laws of unitarity in quantum mechanics. You're not allowed to do that. So the solution is to say that these two points are referring to the same space-time, but different points of the same space-time. And the only different points I can find for that are the antipolar points, and it works. So this gives me a completely valid description of black holes. If you have the antipodes, you find that some of these operators are fundamentally anti-symmetric if you go from the point to the antipoint, which means that now the L of my partial ways all has to be odd. There's something funny and strange about this, but that seems to be coming out. So this is the space side of a black hole. The horizon is here. I removed one dimension in this picture. And so what we now say is that if you go out here, you re-emerge at the other side. That's the boundary condition. It doesn't affect local physics at all. Thank you. So local physics is totally obeyed in all respects, but I did something nasty with the boundary condition, and it works amazingly well. I had some other things. The title of my talk was also about virtual black holes. A virtual black hole seems to be an instanton where you have excavated a region out of space-time, and if you enter into that excavation region from this end, you pop out immediately at the other side. So this is a boundary condition that where you remove this vacuole, I call it. It's not even space-time, it's nothing. Nothing has been described in the interior. But when you enter here, you exit there. That's actually in four dimensions because also time is reversed. Lots of interesting things to be said about time reversal, but this is a four-dimensional instanton. And what I was want to talk about, but I'm going to end now, is maybe there are many, many virtual black holes in this universe. Is there real particles or also virtual particles? Virtual black holes are virtual vacuoles, and you can make even more of them. And you get that many, many particles, black holes, virtual black holes for vacuoles. As you might notice, it makes space-time do something that looks like a fractal. And maybe this generates a two-dimensional structure in space-time, because all these horizons are two-dimensional surfaces. So we had to talk previously, sometimes people think that we go from two dimensions to four, from four dimensions to two dimensions if you go to very high energy. Maybe this is the mechanism. But I ran over my time, so I will end here. Thank you.